There we go. All right, welcome everybody to our tri-weekly Juju Charms Office Hours. So what this is an open hangout where not only do we cover what's going on the latest in the Juju community and Charm community, but we kind of go over things that are landing in Juju Core, what people are working on, what cool technologies are landing in the Juju Charm Store, and in general, just kind of sit around and talk about what we've been doing for the past 3 weeks and communicate, be as open about this to you as possible. So today I got the usual suspects, and I got two new people. So Corey and Marco, in that order, introduce yourselves, and then we'll move to the other folks.
Hi, I'm Corey. I work on the big data team on the ecosystem solutions.
Marco Cheppi, I work on the Juju developer experience team, working around tooling, testing, and benchmarking.
All right, we have two new people. We have Rick and Wayne. Go ahead and introduce yourselves, guys.
Sure, Ben. I'm Rick Harding. I manage one of the Juju UI engineering teams that do the GUI and jujucharms.com and all that fun and joy.
And I'm Wayne Witzel. I'm a developer on the Juju Core team.
Awesome. J-Ren is not here, and I know we've had a lot of comments from people saying, why does that J-Ren guy show up and not tell us what he's working on? So instead, we sent Rick here to tell us what's going on in UI engineering. And we're going to try to get Kevin to explain this cool new syslog data analysis bundle, which is amazing. So who wants to go first? Rick, you feel like going first?
Sure. Yeah, I got some stuff. Sure.
All right, show us what you
want. Well, one thing, I'm gonna put some links in here, and when I do this, I'm going to show some.
Put them in IRC, put them in hash juju.
Oh, put them in hash juju? Alrighty.
Yep.
Alright, so the first thing here is a link to, we've been working on, we kind of landed this thing called V4 bundles. Basically, you know, there was an old API for stuff, and it was called the V3 API when we first introduced bundles to Juju. And when we worked hard to put bundles in the actual charm store where you can actually upload them to the same charm store that the charms live in. And what's kind of interesting is that as part of that, we did some tweaks to the actual bundle format to make that happen and make it reasonable and all that kind of stuff. So lately, as we've gotten the deployer, the Juju deployer now supports V4 bundles. The GUI supports them all. Quick Start supports them all. We've been working on the documentation and stuff around that. So which I linked to here is kind of the documentation link that goes through bundles. We've worked to update the docs to make it more clear. What is a bundle? What's the right format? One of the new things V4 introduces is the ability to specify machines, which is kind of slick because it lets you say, you know what, I want machine 1 with these constraints, machine 2 with these constraints, and put these things on these machines. Mm-hmm. The key part is that those machines can't exist yet. This is not about machines in your environment because we want bundles to be reusable. So what we don't want is someone to grab a bundle and try to deploy it and then get big error messages that you can't deploy it because you don't have a machine 3 and therefore it won't work. But kind of a new little bit of format. But the other thing to kind of point out while we're at this is we put a lot of love lately into the documentation side of things. The Juju Charms docs now supports multiple versions. And we've cut down the list of the nav to just the supported versions. So you'll notice in the navigation, the currently supported are 118, 20, 22, 24. And we've got devil and stable links, which kind of move around to what the latest versions are. Now, the other versions, like 121, are still in there. They're just not linked directly. So if you had an old link on your blog or whatnot, that will still work and pull up that doc page. But so we think it's been really cool. We've worked really hard with the docs team on some formatting, some design, decoration, getting all the multi-version stuff correct and really making the docs awesome. Yes.
Yeah, so the 118, 120, 122, 124, those are the current stable release versions of Juju that we support, correct?
Yes, the canonical supports as far as what's in, because at the end of the day what we support is what's in certain, whatever the LTSs
right.
and things are. So.
Right.
And so those will shift over time, right? I mean, when we get to the next LTS, you'll see some of those knock off and some new ones come on, and, you know, that's the way of the world.
Okay, so if I start searching for versions of documentation and they're seem to be being removed from the internet, I probably should check my Juju versions, what you're saying.
Yeah, well, you might notice that, yeah, if it were to fall away from that, you may realize it's time to upgrade. Mm-hmm. But again, the docs are actually there, so like, let me select this bundle one, for instance. I think I'm going to try this on the fly, and it's probably going to completely fail on my face, right?
Nope, I already tried it. If you just Google for Juju bundles, it will take you directly to this page.
Right, no, but what I was thinking was that we could do 1.23 or something. Let's see. So I got a 124 page. Can I get a 123 page? And I can't. And you know why? I think it's because we recently added it and it's not backported yet. But I wonder if I had a different page it should work. But anyway, so there's some kind of fun. And yes, I will say one nice thing we've done with it, we've made sure to improve the Google juice of the docs a bunch. I know at one point in time we had a small outage where the docs weren't, search wasn't working correctly, and my email to the Juju list was, guys, use Google, search for Juju constraints, and it will link you directly to the proper docs page. So, hey, it's good to know that if we break our own search that there's stuff out there filing a bug.
Yeah, and I noticed that you guys started doing the search because before I didn't have any Google juice at all. Now I'm actually confidently I'm able to to just ask Google and then it does it. Because I'm constantly like trying to find ways to have that not work so I could yell at you, and I haven't had to yell at you for a long time. So I mean that seems to be really working a lot as far as the indexing and whatnot too, and the results too. I've noticed as well, especially in the charms pages, have gotten a lot better. Right, like before it'd be like, you tried WordPress. Did you really mean this IRC proxy? And now what? Like now they're like kind of related. You're at least getting stuff that are written in the similar language and whatnot, which I thought was cool.
So the docs are a big thing. But to jump back to the bundle stuff, so everyone, if you're out there working on bundles and things, make sure to update your format. The Charm Store automatically, when it pulls in a bundle, will convert your V3 bundle to a V4 bundle. Mm-hmm. And so you'll notice, like, in your list of your files of your bundle, you'll see a bundles.yaml.orig, the O-R-I-G. That's what was actually in your repo. And then there's a bundle, non-plural.yaml, and that's what we turned it into. But folks, you know, should go back and update that bundle.yaml and improve upon it over time and kind of move to that format. It's no big secret. One of the things that we're working on, and you'll see code landing in core and in other stuff, is actually making bundles deployable from the Juju CLI itself in Go. So, but that will only support V4 bundles. So pretty soon you'll be able to do like Juju deploy MediaWiki single and actually deploy that bundle straight with Go code in core. But that will only work for bundles that are V4. And yes, Corey notes, we just got through reviewing a branch of his today that added charm proof updates for V4 bundles. So,
are we going to? Oh boy, I shouldn't have thought about this question. Are we going to be doing like an automated run through everything in the store with a proof and output which ones are busted so we can fix them?
Well, that question, we thought about this. The question is defined busted, right? We do translate V3 to V4, but we don't actually run through and like run proof against them all or anything at the moment for the V4 ones. So there's other work going on where that'll help make that easier in the future. But I don't know that we've got a big giant audit thing on our hands that we're ready to go through and do at the moment.
Okay, and just help me out as I'm looking at some of these bundles compared to my older bundles. What's like the telltale TLDR diff? Like, what's the biggest difference in the four bundles?
The big thing is the one reason we did this, one of the big reasons, was we wanted to support pretty URLs for bundles, right? So if you remember before, there used to be a site called manage.jujucharms.com/whatever. And then what you would notice is that it would have this funky URL. It would have part of a name slash the actual bundle name. And so what it was doing was is bundles used to be able to support more than one bundle per file, right? So you've got three different bundles, three different ways to deploy MediaWiki. You may put them in one file. And so when we put them in the store, we had to be able to tell them apart. So we would take like the name of the BZR repo, and then we would add on whatever each bundle name was in the file. So we had what we called a basket slash a bundle name. And what we did is we said, you know what, that's crazy, it makes the URLs ugly, let's get rid of the basket, let's mandate one bundle per file. And so the old format, you'll notice it says, what was the top key? There was an upper key that was like bundle, colon, and then all the names was the next one.
Right, exactly.
And so what we've done is we've taken the bundle name is the top key. So if you look at that top key and it's not the name of the bundle, then you know you're looking at a V3 bundle. That's the big thing. And if you want...
Because before they were like env export. That's when I knew someone wasn't paying attention.
Yeah, well,
if they uploaded a bundle and it said env export, I'm like, you didn't test this.
Yeah. Let me pull up the we've actually got a migration doc in the Charm Store documentation, which we should probably – I think we ported over some of it. I don't know if all of it made it. But let me see. I'll put another one in here. Just ping it to you, George. This kind of walks through V3, V4, what kind of the difference is a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of this, like again, was subsumed by the actual Juju docs.
Sure, so. Sure. And for those of you that are just listening in, if you go to github.com/juju/charmstore, that's where you should find all the stuff in there. Just do a quick search for bundles in that repository and you should be fine.
Yeah.
And there's all sorts of examples and stuff. Is it sad that I'm only seeing this for the first time?
I know Marco
went through this with a fine-tooth comb.
I was going to say, I know all the stuff. When we first introduced these, we put them in the Charm Store, and we went through the migration stuff. We went through a big Juju mailing list thing and all that. But it's the kind of thing I'm sure, you know, you see an email that says, because we're not deprecating version 3 stuff until the end of the year,
right,
to give everyone time to update to new APIs and new formats and all that. But the big thing is we're starting, you know, we're heading that route, right? Like we're at the end of August. It's getting to a time where we're making decisions that certain features will only be forward-looking and not backward-looking.
Right.
So it's getting to be that time where everyone who was like, I don't have to worry about that, that's the end of the year.
Yeah, so, I really like, I just want to say when you do 2: Alexi : new, that's pretty sweet. That's whoever did that, good job.
Yeah, no, that was some guys on the team. Madison, Francesco did a lot of this with some Jeff, and we chatted with some guys from Core. So it was a good team effort on getting this stuff going, which is really awesome.
That is awesome. And when do you expect Bundle 4 to land? Like,
Bundle 4s are done. You mean bundles in Core in the actual command line? Right now we're targeting to get the work done into Juju 1.26, which the schedule on that's a little bit, they're working out some release schedule stuff, and it's not in my hands. I believe that's in January, but don't quote me on it. Well, I think 1.25 is October, right? So 1.25 is locked, and that's released next month. It's feature frozen.
Yeah.
And so I think we're in the next release after the 1.25. So that's what we're going to try to get stuff into.
Okay, cool. Anything else? Anything else from the for the GUI team? Anyone in IRC have any questions?
Yeah, shoot.
Yeah, the machine specifications. You mentioned that the machine numbers cannot already exist. Are those if you deploy a bundle that specifies machine 0, is it always going to fail because that's the bootstrap?
No. We couldn't figure out a good way of doing this, right? So what we're saying is that within the scope of this bundle, there will be a new machine called 0. Gotcha. And really it should, if we could give it some name like new 1.0 or new machine 0 or something, we could have, but bundle doesn't really support that at the moment. So when I say 0, it's a little confusing, and I apologize for that, and I wish we could have figured out a better way of doing that.
So you're saying they're like virtual machine numbers.
Yeah, they are right. They are virtual machine numbers completely scoped within that bundle. What happens is it says, okay, I need 4 machines, 0, 1, 2, 3. It asks Juju, give me this machine, and when Juju says, all right, that machine is number 13, it replaces the 0 with 13 and all the subsequent calls, right?
Perfect.
So it just maps it all out for you. That way, they're completely reusable. One other thing, and this is not us. I'm completely taking credit for some stuff on Core because we've been playing with it, and it's so awesome that I want to kind of share and get folks to play with it. This is all completely work in progress. But again, I'm going to share some links here into some docs. There's two of them. There's systems and users. And I don't know if you guys have heard or not, but Juju's been working on, you know, when you Juju Bootstrap right now, you have what, you know, has been previously called the Bootstrap node or the Juju server, all kinds of stuff. And the Juju Core team has put in a lot of work and done some awesome stuff to make it so that you can run multiple Juju environments with one set of state servers, right? So, and what that's called is it's being called a Juju system, right? So this, you bootstrap, and what you get is a Juju system. And once you have a system, you can create multiple environments within that, which means you don't have to wait for future bootstraps at all. The other cool thing is they've added user support. So as I bring up these environments, I can then add users to those environments. So one of our tests we did the other day is one of the guys on the team, he went to EC2, and he brought up a Juju system, and then he added a user account for everyone on the team and gave us all user credentials. So in this way, he could share out his environment to all of us with this new feature that they're working on getting into Juju Core. What's awesome is that if you want to run HA Juju system, that's 3 machines, but I might be able to run, you know, a half dozen environments with that, which means instead of 6 machines running, I get HA at half the cost.
Right, exactly. And it seems like one of those things, like, for example, I don't know how other people on the cloud do this, right? But for us, we run our stuff in the cloud, and then we, like, expense it, and then we pay, and it's, like, a separate thing. With this, you could have, like, the guy who controls the account with, like, you know, dole out the access creds and stuff.
Our big use case we're looking forward to this for is we run a MAS system. We've got a 6-node MAS cluster in my basement, right? So what we do is in MAS, you can get one set of Juju credentials for each user in MAS, and we run 3 different Juju environments. So we have 3 MAS users for no good reason at all, just because that's the way it maps out. Mm-hmm. So what we're looking at is what we can do is we can actually on MAS Juju bootstrap onto one of our MAS nodes and then create environments and deploy across the other 5 nodes without worrying about bootstrapping 3 different times, one for each one.
Right.
Yeah.
Because if you think about it, if you have your own cloud internally, every time one of your developers bootstraps an environment, you lose a machine. Right? So like, not a physical machine, but a machine's worth 15 dudes. Yeah. That's 50 bootstrap nodes, right? Okay, yeah.
So anyway, this is really early. It's behind a feature flag. You have to run Juju with a feature flag command in order to get it to run. But for us, this is, like, amazingly exciting, and I think this is something that really I think will be good for Juju. And I would encourage folks who are experimenters and really into playing around with some alpha stuff or whatnot to give this a try out and let us know what you think and get some real user feedback. I'm sure the guys would love some feedback as far as how this works and all that.
Yeah, and with that, let's move to what's happening in core, because I see Wayne's getting really impatient with us. Is this what you worked on, Wayne, or you work on other parts?
No, yes. I have nothing to do with this. It sounds great, though, and I'm excited to use it. But the stuff my team is working on is specifically for right now we're focused on workload processes for units. What that essentially distills down to is the ability to expose information about running processes for a given charm, for a given unit. Docker, KVM, Supervisor D, stuff like that. You might want to have extended information for that workload.
Okay, so let me ask you a few questions here since you're talking about status, right? You know, when I have a charm that has new status and it's all blingy and I get a whole bunch of – when I do my watch Juju deploy and I get a whole bunch of status updates like that, or are you talking deeper?
Similar to that, yeah. So there will be a Juju command specific for showing the status of embedded workloads in a unit. So if your unit is composed of many Docker containers or many running processes, like you're doing microservice stuff within a single unit, there'll be a command. There'll be hook environment commands that allow you to register those long running workloads with Juju. It'll expose status information from the workload to Juju, and then Juju will report that back out using a periodic update so that the user can see the status of their different workloads.
Okay, so we're talking a lot deeper than the kind of fancy mod that's what we're basically using now, right? Even though we call it the fancy status. Okay.
Yeah, the motivation behind this is talking to a lot of people who are charming up things with Docker or KVM or running their own process manager embedded within a charm. The ability to see what that unit is running before you destroy it or take it down is becoming more important than it used to be when we weren't potentially running, you know, 15, 20 different things on a single unit.
Okay. Do you have any examples or pseudo commands of what this command would look like, or are you guys still pretty much in the guts phase and not really?
Yes. Well, there's going to be. We're still kind of in the figuring it out phase, but we've got most of the commands pinned down. There's a Juju workload register. These are for the hook environment. You have a Juju workload register, a Juju workload launch command, and then a Juju workload status command. Associated commands for unregister and, track. It's actually Juju track workload, Juju launch workload, and Juju workload status, and then you have Juju workload untrack and Juju workload destroy, and those are the hook environment commands. Then we also have there's going to be a CLI command called Juju PS.
Okay.
And that Juju PS will specific, and you'll be able to provide unit filters or service level filters to that PS command, and that will give you the specific workload status for a given unit or a given service.
That sounds awesome. Also,
Do you have plans to have a way of using these microservices to serve as relation endpoints?
Yes, so you can currently map within the, there's going to be a workloads.yaml file where you'll essentially define all of your workloads for a given charm unit, and in there you will have the ability to map relations as well as storage endpoints for the, and you, that's if you need to do it in a declarative fashion. If you need to do it dynamically, you can also pass those options in on the command line in the hook using the actual track command. So there's an actual, I'm trying to remember the current syntax. I think it's just dash dash relation endpoint, and you map you map in the relation definition that you want to map it to within the, or that the relation definition that the workload fulfills that the charm has defined in its config and metadata. And ports too, so it'll, like you can pass in and expose ports. So the underlying mechanism for a workload, we currently are supporting KVM and Docker. But the a long-running, you know, workload. So it's an example that I used earlier was Supervisor D. You know, if you have some type of system that already depends on Supervisor D for bringing processes up and down and managing them, you could essentially write a charm that was able to facilitate that, create the relations for all those things, know the ports that were being exposed, and get that information back up at the Juju level, so that you could easily relate services and create all the relations and volume and mount volumes and stuff like that.
All right, is that it? Sorry, I had to step out for a minute. Had a dog issue.
Yeah, so there's a feature branch that has a lot of this work in it. I'll put the link in Pound Juju on IRC that yep. People can look at. You compile it and run it. There's all the current documentation is source level documentation that's in like the.
Of course it is.
In the doc comments of the code, but there will be full documentation for this feature. There's hopefully going to be some actual demos of the feature coming very soon. We recently did a big rework of it, and so they're kind of behind on our current set of demos, but we'll should have something very soon. And that's it.
Yep. Yeah, go ahead and put that in IRC. Sorry, what I'm working on doing is compiling a list of everything that we're putting in IRC and putting it in the YouTube video description. That way you can just deal with it that way. With that, if you have any questions, we're still in #Juju on Freeno if you want to ask Wayne any questions. If not, I'm sure he'll mute and then just work in the background and do whatever it is he's doing. So thanks, Wayne, for having us on. Looking really forward to seeing that. I think when Mark's always talking about the ability to not just, you know, hey, Juju client, what's going on? Like, to be able to see all the way deep inside, I think, is what people really want. And that sounds really hard. So I'm really glad you're working on that. With that, a little bit something. So that's all future great stuff. That's awesome. But Kevin has been working on something that you could use today. And I had the pleasure of demoing this at the Chicago Lug. And this is a charming bundle that features status. It has awesome actions. It's like tested, which is like really weird. So, Kevin, I keep calling this a syslog big data bundle thing because that's a description. I don't know if it needs like a better name or if I'm just totally butchering it, but like, why don't you just start off with showing us the page, what the bundle looks like, tell us the problem you're trying to solve, and kind of just give us a little tour. I mean, you don't have to fire it up or anything like that, but I was really excited when I saw this working, and the pterosaur was like doing really awesome stuff.
All right, so you didn't butcher the name. It is called a real-time syslog analytics bundle, and I'll post the link there in Pound Juju, and I'll share my screen to walk folks through this to give an idea of what it's doing. But this is a really exciting bundle for us because it's sort of our in the past, we've had bundles where we just deploy our services and relate them and prove that we've got this kind of core data processing thing that will work. But what we've done with this bundle is really have an end-to-end solution for people. And by end-to-end, I mean we're going through ingesting big data, then doing some storage on it, putting it in HDFS in our case, running jobs on it, processing things, and then we've also added the visualization component on the end of it. So when you deploy this bundle, you're really getting a solution to a big data problem. And in this case, we're calling it the syslog analytics bundle, but we expect to have bundles that will not only work for logging, but also for Twitter feeds or any kind of social media ingestion points. So it's something that we're excited to expand in the future. Just to walk through sort of the layout of what you see on the canvas, I can get my canvas centered. That diamond in the upper left there, that's our core Apache Hadoop offering. And this is a part that's typically pretty difficult to install and configure correctly. We take some of that difficulty away from you or remove it so you don't have to worry about it. We have pre-configured the HDFS master and Yarn master to talk to any of your compute slaves in a cluster. And if you've ever had to deploy Hadoop before, you know that's not really a trivial task. There's lots of Etsy hosts configuration to be passed around the cluster. Things need to know how to talk to one another, so the right ports have to be open. It's kind of a mess. So we're real happy to offer that diamond there in the middle, and that's a core piece of all of our bundles that we're putting up is just this ability to throw out real easily a core Hadoop building block there. The real money comes in when you talk about this plugin charm, sort of to the right there on the screen. This plugin charm is what allows us to drop services into our model and have it pre-configured to talk to the cluster. It's just a way to hook whatever big data service that you might be interested in into the pre-configured and pre-existing cluster. This is really cool because there, if you've ever looked at the Hadoop space, there are just oodles of services that can go along with a Hadoop ecosystem. There's, like I mentioned, stuff for ingesting. So you've got the Flume and the Kafkas of the world. Stuff for data processing like the Sparks. Sparks is all the hotness right now. And then the visualization side of things. You've got Hue and Python notebooks and the Apache Zeppelin project, which I think just came out of incubator status recently. So there's really a bucket load of services that you probably want to use in your Hadoop solution. And this plugin charm really allows you, as the solution author, the person that's trying to solve the problem, to jack into a pre-configured cluster without having to worry about any of that stuff on the left. You get to do the fun parts, which is the stuff on the right. I actually have a deployment running, so I'm going to switch my screens here to show off some of the status that you have so graciously...
spoiled? Did I spoil the surprise?
Yeah, but that's all right. So if you're watching my screen now, this is a deployment in progress of that bundle. This bundle is a 9-unit deployment, and you can see at the actual status messages that are most interesting is that we'll have some services that are waiting on things, and it's nice to know what your deployment is doing while you're doing it, right? So we see a lot of the things are ready and ready to start performing their job, but the more interesting parts to me are the things that are blocked or waiting on stuff. And this is a nice way to show off that, no, your deployment isn't hung. You're not in trouble here. It just, in this case, for the Flume HDFS service, we're simply waiting for the plugin to install the jar files and connect up the backend cluster to Flume. So that's something interesting to me. If you'll scan down a little bit farther, we have another service that we're going to show off here in this bundle. That's the Zeppelin web interface. Of course, Zeppelin in our use case here depends on Spark, so we can see that Spark isn't quite ready yet. It should be any second now. You'll see these statuses flop over depending on where they are in their deployment cycle. So I just wanted to showcase that these big data charms and all the charms that we've been writing recently have really taken advantage of the extended status support. I mean, we think, well, actually, I mean, we know that this is a blessing to those that have tried to deploy Hadoop clusters in the past. Sometimes it's really troubling to be an hour in and realize, you know, something's hung or something's waiting on something and you don't really have a good idea of what it is. We are hopeful that this provides that level of information that folks are interested in seeing. Once those things fire up, I can show what we're going to ingest, but while we're waiting on it, I'll just talk about it. This bundle utilizes the remote syslog capability. It's not something that the big data team wrote within Canonical. That was just an R syslog charm that happens to be in the ecosystem already. So it kind of shows off the flexibility of you've got this idea, you've got this solution that you want, but you don't have to design every component of that. You can
steal someone else's work.
I wouldn't say steal, I'd say leverage, but yeah, we can leverage things. So right now in this deployment, we've got the R syslog listener sitting on the HDFS master, which is an important thing to get syslog events for, and that just fires over to Flume and shoves data into HDFS. So it's an all-around bundle that we're really proud of, just to show off data as it gets generated all the way into Hadoop and then out the other side. But yeah, please give it a try. You know, it takes 9 units. They can all be relatively small. I think when I leave these up, I deploy this kind of stuff all the time, and it costs me about $60 a month on Amazon, which is relatively inexpensive for talking about a full functioning big data product that you can sort of play around with and bolt into.
I noticed your bundle also has specific machine constraints, so you can't accidentally not deploy an unscalable one. Like I went ahead and deployed all M3 mediums because I was like, I want this to run okay and pretty decent. Then I noticed that you had machine constraints in your bundle, which is really nice. It's also a good example, I think, of a modern charm doing modern things with modern status and stuff. So like, even if you're not an expert, when it was coming up in that little view with the watch doing the status, like, I could relatively, you know, with my limited understanding of Hadoop, kind of, oh, okay, we're kind of still waiting on this, you know. So that was really cool. I really like that. And we'll have the URL, of course, in the description with that. Any if we don't have any questions from Kevin from our esteemed panel or IRC yet. So with that, Corey, you want to go next? Or Marco, you guys want to fight over who's gets to go next?
I can go next.
Okay.
So I'd like to talk about something that we're just putting the finishing touches on in the charm a new pattern for developing charms. It's we call it Composer, and it leverages the reactive pattern, which I've mentioned in passing here before. But it is a way of go ahead and share my screen real quick. It is a new approach to writing charms that allows you to break up complex charms into layers, and then the layers can be reused on other charms. This particular charm is a layered version of the vanilla forum software that is in the current getting started documentation, and it leverages an Apache base layer. And the MySQL relation stub, so that the guts of this charm, other than the various YAML configuration, Apache YAML and Composer YAML, the code for this charm is very succinct, straightforward. It's easy when you open it up to see that it's reacting to when the database, when the Apache is finished being set up and the database is available, you set up the vanilla software and then start Apache. All of the details about setting up Apache and installing that are handled in the Apache base layer. All of the details about setting up the interacting with the database, connecting to it, handling the negotiation back and forth over the relation is handled by the MySQL interface. So it makes it very easy to kind of leverage these pre-built parts, which we plan to expand what interfaces are available for all the common cases to make it really easy to use the various relations without having to go into the code and read exactly how these relations have to be used. And to be able to build upon things like Apache or Nginx or Docker as a base layer to add your solutions on top of without having to every time worry about how to install Apache, what packages you need to worry about. It reduces the copy paste issue with charms and allows you to kind of get the same benefit to the copy paste without actually having to copy and paste it into your layer. And the idea behind this is that these layers, while being maintained separately, are composed together using a charm command, charm compose. And when I run this, it will tell me in just a moment that it's pulling in the various layers. And so it pulls in the Apache layer, which pulls in the basic layer, composes those together. It doesn't mention the MySQL, but it's and the HTTP, but it's doing that. And then if I go down to where it put my generated charm, it created a charm from those layers that has all of the bits from each of the layers combined together, and they hook together using the reactive pattern. So that you get a full, complete charm where everything, all the logic is in one place. So when you look at it on the charm store, it is a complete charm, but you don't have to manually copy and paste all the various bits into your end result charm and maintain that large amalgamation of various things. And then you can rerun the composer to get updates. You know, when the base layer is the Apache layer is updated, you just rerun Composer, it pulls in the new changes, and then you can see what has changed in your charm and push that up to the store very easily. So, did you want me to go into any more depth in this, or?
I don't know. It seems that Marco has some opinions.
Yep.
No opinions at all. I think this is great. It's something that we've seen a lot in the community where we'll just tell people like, oh, here's a charm that basically does what you want to do. Just kind of fork that and run with it. The problem is that as that charm you fork gets better, there's no way to distill that betterness to your charm without having to do a lot of code around. So I think what this does, and I think what Corey and I think Corey Ben and a few other guys have been working on with this stuff is it makes it so that people can write really good, knowledgeable layers. Like I know how to control Nginx inside and out. And that I can produce a layer that any charm can inherit. And a charm author, as I iterate on that layer, a charm author can just come in and say, oh, I can rebuild my charm with this improved layer now, which has better security, better features, etc. So at the end of the day, you're still producing a charm. All the code you want is there in that charm. The charm store has that full code, but it's actually comprised from multiple smaller composable components. And it's a really cool feature, I think. And I think Corey, you guys have done a great job on it.
Yeah. So a question I'm going to have, as someone who helps run and manage the charm store, right, it seems to me that if I were to look at a charm and look at how it works, I don't see how the charm is actually built and works. So I guess are there any plans to try to figure out a way of exposing the original source for this somehow through the charm store so that if I'm like, hey, this charm is great, I would like to do like what it does or something, I can actually see what really happened? Because it's indirect, right? Like what the charm store sees as far as what your hook file looks like is actually different from what you wrote.
Right. And to address that, then is created a library as part of the compose that allows you to inspect where each piece came from, which layer. In this charm inspect command, it's being used to just create a color coded tree output, but the intention was once we kind of get some more of the finishing touches on this, to start working with you guys to integrate this into the store so that when you're looking at the added composed charm in the store, we can easily expose, you know, this file came from this layer, this file came from this layer, and make it easy to see where the various bits came from.
Yeah, because we should. we should chat about it just because I know oftentimes when I hit a bug or something in a charm or I get a hook failure or something and it gives me some kind of error message, the first thing I do is like I'll go look up that charm on ggcharms.com and look at the files and go, okay, let me just grab like the hook, you know, the hook for what was changed and then look at what the code was doing and kind of chasing that stuff down. But it sounds interesting. But it'll be kind of cool to flesh that out a little more.
Are there any plans for ways to expose or to search as for what layers will give me what? So, like, I'm running a charm and it needs, like you said, MySQL and Apache. Is there going to be a mechanism, preferably through the CLI, through like the command line, where I can just, while I'm in my charm, I can go out to the shell and say, oh, show me every layer that's available somewhere that implements MySQL, and then I can pick one right there? Because one of the problems I have right now when I'm doing a new charm is, even if I'm just copying and pasting an existing charm and because it already does a lot of the work that I want to do, it's still difficult for me to find that specific charm sometimes that has maybe the relations I want or the that kind of is providing those relations that I'm looking for. And so an easy way to find those layers would be nice.
Yeah, absolutely. So I just put a link in the IRC channel. Interfaces.juju.solutions. That's the UI on that is really rough first cut. But it has that is where the API lives, and also where you can see a list of the current currently very limited selection of interfaces and layers. The API has a search built into it, which is, I believe, exposed. It's not exposed right now, but it has search built into it already, so we just need a way of exposing that via the CLI and via the website, but it is definitely part of the API already to some degree.
One thing I'll note along those same lines is the ggcharms.com search actually supports searching on relation names. So if you know you're looking for something that needs like a db-admin, you can actually go into that search box and type db-admin, and the charms you get back in the results are charms that have that relation in it.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I just get I gave you a link to the query.
I see that, admin. Dude. You know, it'd be awesome. Take this as a verbal bug report.
okay, the best
like
kind.
You know how sometimes you see a search engine in Google and it says try colon blah blah blah, like, yeah. And it's a new different like example in light gray.
Yeah,
I did not know we could search for freaking interface names in the search. Did you know, Marco?
What I'll do is
I know everything. So
Hold on one sec. Let me get.
That makes me sad. I didn't know that. That's awesome.
So along with the charm store docs that we talked about earlier with the bundles, there's an API doc, and so basically what ggcharms.com is doing is it's using the API. And so if you look here, I'm going to put the link here in channel here or in the IRC channel. The search shows you basically the kinds of things you can search for, including provides and requires and whatnot. And what the search is doing is kind of breaking that down. So you can search for owners, you can search for names, you can search for tags, you can search for these series or the relation points available. So just FYI.
That is sweet. That is good to know. Man, this is like the best office hours we've had in a long time. Everyone's learning something.
So we got your back, Wayne.
Yeah, no, that's great. The provides and requires is a big one for me. That's awesome.
Can we do provides colon blah?
I don't think we do a full colon supported thingy. Yeah. We talked about it. The problem with the colon stuff, because you know a lot of search engines will let you do that kind of stuff, is that one, we use Elasticsearch in the back end, and Elasticsearch has its own keyed things that we collide with, and then two, it's not very discoverable. So we just try to, you know, like Google Search, you just type in what you want, and we do our best to find the best thing we can put together out of what you asked for.
I think you put some examples in there, like just like the light gray thing Google does, like.
Yeah, that's definitely a way to. We could try to rotate some kind of helps, tips and tricks, I guess, through there about how to use search more interestingly.
Okay, I'm going to see if you guys implemented this. Hold on. Okay, Juju Charm Store. Search. No, you didn't implement it. Never mind. There's a little widget some people can implement in their website, and it'll actually kick in the Chrome. I was actually trying that for real.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I wasn't being snarky. There's a... sometimes you can, I don't know if it's a Chrome-specific thing, but you can leverage the OK Google stuff in certain fields. Oh, not my phone just went off.
No, man, we work with WebOps. They already duct tape over their cameras on their laptops, man. They're not going to let all recording all the time kick into what they're searching for.
No, it's interesting because I noticed they had it on normal Google, and I was looking into it.
Yeah.
So, like, if a field supports it, you can put a little microphone there. It's explicit. I mean.
Yeah. No, that's cool. That's interesting. I hadn't seen that it was more widely available. I'd play with it on Google's, but not elsewhere. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's a total pie-in-the-sky feature anyway. I mean, I don't see people deploying by talking to their laptop, but I just thought that'd be interesting. So. But, yeah, for sure, now that we can search for interfaces, it's super fun. It's, so what happens if you do... Oh, I guess searching for www doesn't... I'm trying to think of a interface that tons of charms use.
HTTP?
That's what I meant to search. Yeah. Not www. What am I thinking? 400 results! But it's not obvious to me that those are...
No, I was going to say that is the one weak spot, obviously, is that you search for something, we found results. The results could be, because we don't know directly why it came up, right? Like, it could have been that it was in the charm name. It could have been that it was in a tag.
Right,
you're getting results that are the best that we can figure out how to map, but we don't directly put on them. We pulled this out because it has a matching relation, right?
Right, but MySQL dash admin returns exactly 16 back, so it knows.
Right, because that's not common on anything else, whereas
right.
HTTP is going to be very common in various summary texts and all kinds of stuff. So.
Yeah, so very interesting. Good to know. That's like your tip of the week, everyone. Actually, I'm going to put that in the partner newsletter for the next one. So cool. All right, and I think that's just about everyone. We're reaching the top of the hour. Any other comments? Concerns, questions, all the URLs, make sure you shove them in IRC in the next few minutes because I'm going to put those in the description.
Thanks for having us in, man.
Yeah, that was really awesome. I think we should have you guys more often. Usually it's just Jay Brand working back there silently, not talking to anybody.
That's because we put him to work.
Mm, that's good. And Wayne's just looking an excuse not to type all day. So. All right, and with that, let's go ahead and close it up. I'll go ahead and announce the next one will probably be around 3 weeks, but we're getting close to hitting the Juju Charmer Summit, so I think what we might do is not have an office hours that week and instead publish the videos that we do from that Charmer Summit.
Oh, come on, man. I want to live from the summit feed.
Yeah, so we don't have like a full real-time professional AV, but we are going to have Randall record them all.
That's right. Just all of you guys like huddled together like shoulder
it's
to shoulder.
It's one track. So if you haven't seen this yet on the mailing list, it's also on Insights. We're having our Juju Charmer Summit in Tyson's Corner, Washington, D.C., September 17th and 18th. Event is free for anybody who wants to show up. Canonical is offering limited sponsorship, so if you're working on charms, let me know, and then we can see what we can do for you. We're going to have basically all of us and 20 or 30 more full-time charmer people, and then we're going to bring in a bunch of people that are doing charms. So our partners, we have IBMers showing up, just about everyone that you've seen announcing the Juju Charm Partnership Program there, and it's going to be 2 full days of charm training, tips and tricks, you know, everything from like how to write better hooks, how to use all this Compose stuff that Corey's working on that I still barely understand. If you have OpenStack specific questions, we'll have the OpenStack specific charmers there. We'll have Wayne from Core if you need like some kind of core feature or something, or you want to kind of figure out what's coming on down the pipeline that'll help you. And of course Marco and crew to kind of just give you the rundown on charm design. So really our intent is to make it so charming is easier, faster for you, so you can get your charms in the store faster and ultimately get your code and your product to your users faster. So that's cool. Oh, awesome. We had someone listening too. Morton on IRC. See? You see that, Wayne? Wayne didn't think anyone was listening. So with that, we'll see you guys from Washington, D.C. We haven't really determined where in the URLs the streams will live, probably on UbuntuOnAir.com. And with that, we'll see you guys in a few weeks. Thanks for listening.